the trouble with being a housewife is that when you don't feel well enough to go to work, staying at home doesn't do any good. I thought this was a very nice proverb to set us thinking about the changing role of man-woman relationship in this 21st century, what actually is happening. Just to recap, and trace the history part of it, we know that the concept of family must have started more out of convenience rather than any rules and regulations. So it was convenient for a man, the caveman, to have a permanent woman in his cave rather than, you know, moving around, changing partners or whatever it is. So started off with the convenience factor, then children came into the picture, then he knew that children can also be useful. So look after them, when they grow up, they will look after me, reciprocation, all that sort of thing. It was convenient for the man because the woman would keep his house or cave or children and maybe cook for him and clean up the place and give him love and affection. And he also had this great sense of ownership, because at that time, when probably there was no money and there was no other concept of you didn't have palaces and buildings and all that, having your own woman was probably a great ego booster for a man. And from the woman's point of view, it must have been a great emotional reassurance to know that this man, wherever he goes, comes back to me, is my man, that sort of thing. So that's how the concept must have developed. And as you know, religion came into the thing. So then man and woman would go to the priest or whatever it is and get blessings, or go to the temple or the church or that sort of thing and get wedded. So there was this commitment to God that, I am not only just partnering with this woman, but I am also answerable to God, and I have this commitment and God is watching me, so I better, have a lifelong commitment. And it kept on going to the stage where even laws reaffirm that you get your marriage registered by law and you can't just walk out. Even if you are very unhappy with your spouse, you have to give reasons to the magistrate, and the magistrate has to be convinced enough to say that yes, you can have a divorce or something. And even that, as you know, one generation back was far and few in between. So it was considered that because there is a religious sanctity and because there is a legal sanctity to it, and of course the emotional sanctity of the fact that children are involved or that society is involved or whatever it is, it was a lifelong commitment. So people did not even think beyond the fact that once you are married, then you live together. Of course, the other factor that was there for many centuries was that the ratio was not necessarily 1-to-1. In almost all societies, there was a practice in some form or the other of polygamy. So as long as the man could afford to have more than one wife, he could go ahead and do it. Religion permitted him, laws permitted him, and that's all what went on again for a very long time. Only recently, for example, in 1956, India brought in the Indian Marriage Act, which banned polygamy and things of that sort. So it started becoming more and more structured. But the irony of it is that the more it started getting structured, the less it started becoming that deep inner commitment or emotional or whatever it is. That's the funny part of it. 100 years back, there was no single piece of paper showing that X and Y are man and wife and they have to be together. If a person wanted to walk off, he could just walk off. But there were less instances of breakup of man-woman relationship at that time than there are today. Because the thing holding them back, as I told you, was conscience, was spirituality, was a feeling of, that it is unethical to do this sort of thing, or that I will be punished by God if I do this. And those were the factors which held people. Now that we brought in more of rules and regulations and all that, things have been turning to the other side. And then there has been so much of you know, distraction into various areas. Just in the recent past, if you see the number of things that have been, today's paper, again, there was this case, a very small news article in Times of India tucked into a corner about this person who has got three parents. Did anyone of you read it? It is tucked into one corner, you could just miss it, but if you're interested, you can go back and read it, Times of India today. I don't understand the medical and the biological thing, maybe Vasanta can throw light on it. You have the sperm and you have the eggs. There is something else also, I am told, medically. The third angle, something which... So there was another woman who contributed that, one who contributed the eggs and one who contributed the sperm and this and that, and the child was born of that. So now, who is the mother or whatever it is? And as you know, surrogate motherhood has become pretty common. So, don't be surprised if you're sitting in a DCS class and one of your batchmates suddenly gets a message and she says, "Hey, I'll have to leave, you know, I came to know I've just become a mother, so I better go and see my baby," or something of that. So, don't laugh at it, because these things catch up very fast. Today you may hear some Amir Khan or somebody, Shah Rukh Khan or whatever it is doing it. But it just takes time before it filters down to common society and it becomes accepted. And once it becomes accepted, we even forget what life was before that. How many of us even remember the how life was before mobile phones? You're so used to it. Anywhere and everywhere it is taken so much for granted that you even don't even visualize what it was for life without or before mobile phones or something. So when a change comes in and it comes in so fast suddenly, before it comes in we think, oh, this will never happen. This is only in some Western countries, or this is only these celebrities like VIPs or film stars or something of that sort. And before you know it, you come to know that your next door neighbor is doing it, and then your niece or somebody comes and says, "I'm planning to do it," or something of that sort. So why I'm telling you this is, particularly when we talk about man-woman relationship, the traditional role of the woman as the mother, or the concept of motherhood, is changing at a very rapid pace. It started off with adoption becoming a very accepted thing. I am the secretary of the state, Karnataka State Adoption Coordinating Agency, and for the last almost 10 years now, we have been jobless. Before that, we used to do extensive awareness campaigns on adoption. We used to do workshops, seminars, we used to give talks to people saying that, you know, if you want to have a child, biological, giving birth to a baby is not the only way. You can also adopt a child. And there are so many children already brought into this world who don't have parents and who don't have a home. So it is mutually beneficial. The child gets a home and you get a baby to complete your family and things of that sort. And we used to have to do that extensive campaign. It's been more than 5 years, or nearing 10 years now, that we have stopped all our campaigns for the simple reason that we have this huge list of parents waiting in the queue to adopt children, and there aren't enough children available for adoption. 10-20 years back it would have been unbelievable. And the trend started about 10-15 years back, when we suddenly realized that more and more people are asking for girl babies and not for boys. Otherwise, traditionally adoption, if at all accepted by a family, was to have a son so that, you know, he continues with the legacy, whether it is the Maharaja of Mysore or whether it's a commoner or anybody, it used to be having a son who can continue with the lineage or whatever it is, even to the extent that I will not get moksha unless I have a son who will light pyre to my dead body or something of that sort. That's just one generation back. And from there we have turned over so much that, as I told you, first we started off with more of girl babies being adopted and boys being left behind in orphanages. Today, neither girls nor boys are available. That in fact makes me happy, because I was getting a little disturbed with the trend that, men are losing whatever little control we had over the thing. So people want girl babies and not boys. And then, of course, I don't know when it will come, but I don't think it will be very far away that we will have the concept of cloning. And that will be the end of the last use of the man. After that, men may as well retire and go back to Mars or wherever they came from. There will be no need left for that. Now, these are the type of changes that have come in. And then, of course, yes.
Girl babies are being adopted more. Abandoned girls, or is
it no. Statistically, there were not more abandoned girls, but the fact was that people stopped adopting for the sake of that lineage and all that. They started adopting only to have a child, a baby in the house. So instead of, if we can't have it, initially 99% of adoptions were because I am childless and I don't have children. I want to have children, so I adopt. Then it switched over, and now we have, I don't remember the exact statistics, but there are at least 20-30% of adoptive parents who already have a biological child. And they have decided to have another child by adoption, by choice, rather than going in. They are capable of having a second child, but they have decided that it is better that I go in for a child by adoption. So these are the ways in which times are changing and thinking of people is changing and all these type of things. So the concept of family, as it keeps changing, the role of the man-woman relationship also changes. If you had a huge joint family and if the young lady had a mother-in-law and all the elders living in the family, her role vis-a-vis her connection to her husband was different from a nuclear family where they have a equation which is purely one-to-one between the two of them. There's not much of interference. As of today, there still continues to be involvement. I won't use the word interference. There still continues to be some level of involvement. I know of couples, for example, who are married and living in foreign countries, any part of the globe, and yet the lady of the house says that today we have to do this particular puja and we have to do this because my mother-in-law called up from India saying that this is the, they've forgotten what auspicious day, what festival it is, but mother-in-law called up to say this is the thing, and she said you have to do this, so we can't say no to her, so we have to go through this process or something. But I think that is a dying phenomenon. It won't last very long. So the equation now is getting more and more focused on the man-woman relationship and less of involvement of others, whether it is parents or siblings or whatever it is. Similarly, children are moving out faster and faster. So even if earlier you had only one child, that child, and particularly if it was a boy, the chances are that he would continue to live with you, or you would continue to live with them for a very, very long time, even after he's married and he's got his children and all that. If it was convenient to stay, if your house was big enough, he would stay back. He would tell his wife and children that we have to stay with my parents. Or vice versa, if he is doing well in life and he has a good house, the parents would move in with him or something of that sort. Today, that concept is again changing at a very fast pace. Children are flying out of the nest faster and faster. So again, the focus comes back on the man-woman relationship, that the husband and wife are finally going to. And to top all that, longevity is increasing. So if a average woman gets married while she is in her 20s or something, before 30 she gets married, most of the people. So by the time she is 30, she is a mother. By the time she is 45 or maybe latest 50, children have grown up, gone off to hostel, and from there to a job somewhere else, and then married, and then living somewhere, or even migrated away from the country, or whatever it is. So on an average, around 45, a typical Indian middle class woman would be left with what is known as a empty nest. And with the way longevity is going, you will be spending more than 45 years with your spouse. So the first 45 years of your life are over, and now you have come to a stage where you have to look forward to a longer innings, second innings is longer than the first innings. And that is where again the significance of the man-woman relationship comes in. I've been telling this earlier and I'm repeating it. Man-woman relationship or the husband-wife relationship is one which can take you to the heights of ecstasy and joy and pleasure. It can take you into the depths of hell. It can be extremely good. It can transform you and make you into a state of bliss where you can face any other challenge, any other bad relationships. Or it can be so bad that you forget about everything else and that sort of thing. I was recently talking to a very highly qualified professional who is been going through marital discord, and he has been discussing his issue with me. And now he has come down with three very major problems. One is that his mother has been diagnosed in an advanced stage of cancer, and chances are that she is not going to survive beyond a few months. The second is that his very, very beloved and very loved dog, you know, has acquired some ailment, and the vet has said that he's also going to pass away. And on top of that, he has been given some sort of an informal notice saying that in the next 3 months, you leave an institution where he had done very good work for, I think, at least 7 years now he was with them. And for various reasons, he has been told that in the next 2-3 months, you'll have to look for another job. Now, can you imagine a person facing these three issues, you know, simultaneously? All three have come within a span of few days. So mentally, if you ask, his focus should be on coping with these three issues. So when I was just doing a mental exercise with him, I said, you know, can you quantify and say how much each issue is affecting you at an emotional level? He said, these three issues, 10% each, my marital discord, 70%. At the mental or emotional level, he says, even now, I would say that 70% of my emotional turmoil is because of my marital relationship. These three constitute 10%. He quantified it for himself. This is just to give you an example that if things go bad in a man-woman relationship, how far it can pull you down. And vice versa, if things go well, you know, you can face any challenge of life if you know that you have a partner who is going to stand by you, with whom you have a good understanding, and with whom you have that type of harmony. So if you are 45 and you've hit the empty nest, you can happily look forward to the next half a century saying that, okay, as long as my spouse is alive, you know, I'm going to be very happy and I'm going to be a very fulfilled person, and both of us as a team are going to work and do this and do that and that sort of thing. But incidentally, what has happened is that there's a very good quote somebody said the other day. When a man and woman divorce, it does not mean that they have not understood each other. It means that they have finally understood each other. And what they have understood, they don't like. And that, again, is becoming a very, very you know, important phenomenon. Because I think I mentioned this to you, I'm repeating again, that while the divorce rate in India or in a city like Bangalore is going up at a very tremendous rate, the rate of increase of divorce is among couples who have lived together for 20 plus years. It is not, we would like to fool ourselves by saying, oh, nowadays youngsters are very frivolous and they don't have long-term commitment. So 1 year, 2 years down the line, they have a fight and they want to separate. Yes, that is also increasing. I'm not saying no. But the rate at which that is increasing is not comparable to the rate at which people who have been married for a long time. And there again comes all these factors of emptiness and this and that, you know, you hung around for the sake of the children. Now, as the children are grown up, what's the point and that sort of thing. So many of these sort of factors have been coming into play. And that is what we need to understand when we want to work with the relationships. In fact, today's, you know, the middle level generation who have been adults and married and maybe having children or whatever it is, as you know, being referred to as the sandwiched generation. They are the middle part of a sandwich. they have their parents who, as I mentioned to you, live and are living a very complacent life where however bad the relationship is, they know that this is the way it is to be done. There is no turmoil. Your grandmother never had to question herself that am I happy in this marriage or should I seek a separation or divorce, because that thought never struck her. She may have lived 60 years with her husband. If it was happy, she would praise God and say that yes, God has sent me a very nice husband. If she was unhappy, she would say it is my karma, I have to bear it, and there's nothing that can be done. So while there were a lot of disadvantages in the sense that women were trapped into this sort of life, they had no choice. But at the mental or emotional level, if you see, you know, at least they didn't have this confusion. They knew that this is what it is. It's like you belong to a middle class salaried income family. So you know that this is what is the income. Yes, I would like to have this big bungalow, or I would like to buy one of the latest apps which is very expensive. But no, I'm sorry, I have to work on this budget per month, and I don't think I can go beyond that. And I know that my income is not, however efficient I am, my income is not going to be doubled. I may get an increment of 10 or 20%, but I'm not going to get double the income, or I'm not going to run into a lottery or a bonus or something of that sort. So then it becomes simpler by saying that, no, I don't even want it. Now that has been taken away from the previous generation. The younger generation now, I meet, you know, 20-something people, and they have a very different concept. I've actually been meeting girls who come and discuss with me their boyfriend, and they say that I'm seriously contemplating getting married to this guy. So I say, okay, my job is not to tell you whom to marry or whether to marry or not or whatever it is. My job is to help you to understand whether you're going in with the right expectations. So if I can help you to sit and evaluate what are the, you know, factors which will make this marriage happy, compatibility factors, and what are the factors that may create problems for you. If you are aware of both sides of the picture, then you will not be going in for a disappointment, and then you will be able to make the best of your relationship. So if you are doing this thing, and if she comes out with certain negative things, and if I say that, you know, this could cause problem, what are you doing about it? She turns around and says, okay, if it doesn't work out, it doesn't work out. I'll move out, or I'll separate, or something. Can you imagine 20, 30 years back, a girl, you know, going into marriage saying that, if it doesn't work out, okay, I'll walk out of here. It was unheard of. And if, by chance, if she had said it to somebody, she would have been condemned by the whole society, including her own mother. Today, it's not uncommon for a young person to say that I am going to make this effort, I'm going to give my best shot to it, but despite all my efforts, if it doesn't work out, so be it. So they will be this new generation who again will not have an emotional turmoil. They will say, fine, I gave it my best shot, I went in with very good intention, but it has not worked out, so let me move out of this thing and let me move on. But this sandwich generation which I'm talking about are on one side caught with tradition and on the other side caught with modernity. And you are getting exposed to both sides of the picture. You may have one neighbor who just, you know, walked out of marriage just because the husband snores or something of that sort. You may have another couple who have decided not to marry but to have a live-in relationship. So there is no commitment of marriage at all. They will decide when they want to move out. All they have to say is, bye bye, settle the monthly rent till the end of the month, tell the milk fellow not to bring milk from next Monday onwards or something, and happily they can move out from there. So there is this generation, there is that generation, and there is this sandwiched generation. Added to that, particularly from the point of view of women, another factor that is affecting their relationship with their partner is the behavior of children. Children are getting more and more independent, children are getting more and more questioning, children are getting more and more involved, and things of that sort. I have come across dozens of cases where there is matrimonial discord, husband and wife are not getting along together, and the child has gone to either the father or the mother and said, why are you continuing in this marriage? Why don't you walk out? So the child has now become the counselor or the legal advisor or whatever you want to call it. And some of them, very small children, I'm not even talking about grown up or teenagers, even preteens sometimes have being able to say that. Again, as I said, one generation back, if a child dared to say something of that sort, you'd probably get a slap from the parent saying that this is none of your business and you should not get involved or you should not comment on this or something of that sort. So with that, now this question is coming up, that we have started thinking more and more in terms of evaluating how good is our man-woman relationship. And we have choices. We can do a lot of things. For example, when I talk about the divorce rate, please remember that the divorce rate does not include, number one, the poor people who never go to a court of law, because it's a very expensive process. So any poor man, a coolie or that level person, if they decide not to live together, they just walk out. They don't have a piece of paper showing that they are divorced, because in the first place they didn't have a piece of paper showing that they are married at all. So none of these people come under the statistics of the divorce thing. The second is, among the educated and the middle class sector also, there are innumerable people who choose, at least nowadays in this scenario, not to go to a court of law and seek divorce, but to start living separately. So while we have, on the one side, the concept of live-in relationships increasing more and more, we have a equally important sector of live-out relationships. Legally, we are married, but we are living out. We don't live with each other, and we have nothing to do with each other, maybe except some few basic things like some finance or something to do with children or something of that sort, but we are totally disconnected. I know of many people, for example, who have purposely taken up a job in another city, you know, just to get away from their spouse. And the spouse is more than happy that this one is going away. And as far as society is concerned, yes, I was transferred to that place or something of that sort, so I had to go. No, my child is in high school, so my wife felt that, you know, she can't leave and come or something. Or my wife's parents are not well and she can't leave them and come off to the new city, so she's staying there, I'm staying there. You just oblige society, but deep down inside you know that the relationship is over and that you have nothing to do with it. So all these type of things, options are available to people. And remember that there is always this thing called, you know, the problem of plenty. When you have too much, you don't know what to do with it. There was a time when you used to have only vanilla, strawberry, chocolate and pista ice cream, so it was very easy to select. You go to one of these posh ice cream joints and you see some 40 flavors, and it's extremely difficult for you to make up your mind, because by the time you think that one is a good flavor, your eye goes on something else which tempts you even more. So the problem of plenty, that now the choice is not just between continuing lifelong in a relationship or breaking up and going in for a divorce. There are various gray areas and there are various different ways in which you can go into a change. One interesting thing which is still hanging on to the age-old tradition in India and is still not letting go even in metropolitan cities and all that is the beautiful mother-in-law and daughter-in-law relationship. I think India will probably be one of the last countries which will still have this battle of the mother-in-law and the daughter-in-law going on for a very long time to come, because I don't see that influence reducing. I gave an example saying that the family or the couple may be living in a far-off foreign country, they hardly visit once in a year or whatever it is, but the mother-in-law sitting over here dictates to them that today is this auspicious date and you must do this puja and you must do that to the child and this is the way you must bring up your child or whatever it is. So that influence factor is there. How long it will stay, nobody knows. How it will change, nobody can predict. The sad part of it is, at least in our culture and our country, one thing that I have been seeing is, we have reduced the significance of psychology, sociology, anthropology, all these life sciences so much, that we don't go into in-depth research the way we do it in science and engineering and medicine or something of that sort. If you people died and 500 people were affected by it, immediately what happens is that the medical fraternity and the pharmaceutical industry gets together and says, let's start doing research so that if that dengue fever comes again, we should be able to tackle it. So can we do some vaccination for it? Can we look for some treatment for it? Can we devise better systems of testing for dengue fever and identification at an early stage? All that starts off at a very professional and a very in-depth level. But if you have other psychosocial issues, there is no surveys or research or anything. In fact, there are hardly any institutions in this country. Like you have the IITs or the IIMs, there should have been IISSs, Indian Institutes of Social Sciences, which should have been looking into these things, which are far more important than, see, dengue fever may come once in a blue moon, and even if it five people die, it is five people out of how many hundred lakhs in Bangalore city, which is absolutely negligible. Five people die every day in Bangalore by a road accident. But we make it so much because we want to take precautions, we want to look into it and ensure that nothing goes wrong. But here we have, a mother-in-law problem on whom nobody has ever done PhD to find out, how this mother-in-law and daughter-in-law problem can be resolved. Forget about that. One of the most important factors to the woman of today, the most important person in her life, the maid servant. How much research have we done? It's a topic of discussion left, right and center, whether it is at parties, whether it is at neighbors, whether it's in DCS class, everywhere people are discussing maid servants. But on an organized way, are we doing anything to find out that, okay, when all of us have this as an issue, what is it that can be done in the future? 1 year down the line, 10 years down the line, I'm still going to be a housewife, I'm still going to be needing some sort of support and help to run my house. What are the ways and means in which we can work on these things? Nothing is being done. And that is why we keep on going by the concept of trial and error. And when the change comes in, we make a big noise, the media blows it out of proportion. You visualize a situation where tomorrow, one maid servant out of, I don't know, maybe 20 lakh maid servants in the whole city of Bangalore, one maid servant murders her mistress. Can you imagine for the next 72 hours, the whole city will be talking nothing about that, except that. There will be this big hue and cry. Police will say, register all the maid servants and take their photos and get their antecedents checked and don't employ these. There will be some 100 maid servants, put into jail in different police stations on suspicion of something. She was carrying a knife in her purse. That means she wanted to murder me. So I'm influential. I go and tell the thing. They'll say before the second murder takes place, and we get a bad name statistically because two murders took place in the same week. So catch hold of her and put her in jail. And exactly 1 week later, everybody's forgotten about it. And nobody even remembers, nobody bothers, nothing of that sort happens. That is another area which I feel we should, and that's one of the reasons why I'm here with you today, to help you to understand that man-woman relationship is changing at such a fast pace and changing in such unpredictable ways that unless we learn how to anticipate it and be prepared for what is going to happen rather than just be prepared as it when it comes, I will see what to do about it. That is like saying that when a fire breaks out, I will float tenders to find out where I can buy the cheapest fire extinguisher from. You can't live life that way. You have to get the fire extinguishers and keep it. Even if you don't need it for the next 10 years or 20 years, it is still a worthy investment. Because by chance, if a fire had broken out, you would have been able to solve the thing. Yesterday's, I think, Bangalore Mirror had a wonderful article on that bus which was stuck and all that. There was one man, because it was a factory or something, and he came with those two fire extinguishers and came and jumped into the bus and did whatever had to be done. So you imagine that factory never had a fire, but that factory's fire extinguisher probably saved 30 lives of people who were sitting in that bus and who could have been suffocated with the fumes of the smoke or whatever was entrapping them. These are the type of things that I get concerned about, and I want to make you know, to know that we need to do something about it. And most of the time, as I've been telling repeatedly, man-woman relationship is either spoken of very pessimistically. And this is another warning I want to give you. I keep getting more and more and more of young people who say, "Uncle, what is marriage after all? There is no such thing as a happy marriage. Show me one couple who are truly happy. I have not seen. If I see my parents, my uncles, my aunties, my neighbors, my this, my that, everybody seems to have a bad marriage. Everybody is a hypocrite. They pretend this, this, this. So why should we have marriage at all?" Now that is taking some of the young people to the other end of the spectrum, where they are losing faith in the concept of marriage or man-woman relationship or something of that sort. And then if the parliament strikes down the Supreme Court's order on section 377, then people will decide, you know, why have man-woman relationship? Why not have man-man and woman-woman? Because we are of the same gender, we understand each other much better. And that's going to open another factor. So then, you'll say, why is Ali wasting our time by talking about man-woman relationship? Because most of us are into man-man or woman-woman relationship or something of that sort. Again, as I'm saying, it's not a question of laughing over it or being pessimistic. It is a serious matter. Yes, we can enjoy a joke once in a while or whatever it is. It's like that man who came and said one day very happily, saying that for years and years and years we used to have a fight over every issue. Any decision to be taken, me and my wife used to be on opposite ends. If I say yes, she would say no. If I say no, she would say yes. And it would lead to very unpleasant arguments. Finally, one day my wife came out with a fantastic idea. She said, "We can't continue fighting like this for the rest of our life. Let's make a very simple understanding. Let's divide the work, the decision making work, so that I don't interfere in your area, you don't interfere in my area." Sounded good in principle, so he said, "Yes, what is it?" She said, "We'll do one thing. All major decisions you take, I will not interfere. But all minor decisions I will take and you should not interfere." "Ah, that sounds very good." And he said, "Yes, let's go ahead." Then she defined major and minor decisions. She said, "What to do with your monthly salary? Minor decision I will take." "Where do we live? How do we bring up our children? How do we invest or whatever else we do? Whom we make as friends? Where do we socialize? What car we buy?" All that minor decisions I will take. Major decisions. Whether America should attack Iraq or not. Very major decision is going to affect the whole world. You take the decision, I will not argue with you. So again, as I said, either we laugh over it or we feel pessimistic about it. But then, can we not, for example, learn a lesson from this and say, okay, not this ridiculous major and minor decision, but can we not work out something whereby we start looking into it? When we know that man-woman relationship, it has to have some turbulence or the other. The most compatible couples also have issues. Can we not say, okay, this is how we divide, this is what we do if a thing turns up and that sort of thing. Otherwise, we'll be going to the other extreme like they are doing in the US, that prenuptial agreement. We decide beforehand that when we divorce, what is going to be the terms and conditions. So why start with something so pessimistic, like saying that, why not say that as long as we are together, this is how we will deal with these situations. We are going to have fights, we are going to have this and that or something of that sort. Again, another very interesting thing is, as you know, if a bitter divorce takes place, one of the issues that can really hurt is custody of children. You must have all had some friend or some acquaintance who went through a very unpleasant experience of divorce and separation, where the man and woman did not have any emotional connect at all. So probably both of them were content to let go and live their own life. Maybe money would be one factor. The wife would expect the man to compensate. Man would say, "No, she is expecting too much." Even that can be resolved. But the most sentimental issue would be that of children. However much I may dislike or I may even hate my wife, I still love my children, and more so, the more I hate my wife, the more I feel that she will be a bad influence on them, so the children should be with me. So we have had this battles going on, you know, for a very long time about custody of children and things of that sort. I have been coming across, they are very sporadic right now, but I have been coming across cases where there is a dispute on the custody of the child or children, with the husband insisting that the wife should take custody and the wife insisting that the husband should take custody. This is real. Can you believe that, those of you who are parents, can you visualize a situation where you are forcing your spouse saying, please take away the children, I don't want to have anything to do with them. But I'm actually facing cases like that. As I told you, there are not many in number, but the alarm bell is already ringing. I have one case which for the last 3 years they have been living away from each other. The husband has custody of the children. One fine day he gets fed up of the children, packs their bags, goes and dumps the children in his wife's house and comes back. After some time the wife gets fed up of the children. She packs their bags, and since she knows that facing him will be a very unpleasant thing, what she actually does is that he lives on the third floor or something, goes up by the lift with bag and baggage, two small children, they are standing there with the bags over there, she rings the doorbell, gets into the lift and comes down. He opens the door and sees his children and the bags over there. Come, Raghu. Now this again is a new element, but something of concern, where we are slowly becoming a little more selfish, little more self-centered, where a child who meant the world to us, we were willing to do anything and everything for the child. We are coming to the stage where at least some of us are thinking that no, the child is a handicap or something which will hold me back. I would rather not have the child so that I have the freedom to lead my life the way I want to. And that's also leading to a small growing segment, even in India, even in Bangalore, of what was referred to as dink families, double income, no kids. So both have their careers, both are very happy with their careers, both are doing well in whatever it is, both have independent sources of income, and neither of them is interested in having a child, because a child would actually interfere in their careers or whatever. It is not that they are unhappy with each other, mind you. They are happy with each other. They say that, yes, I love my spouse, I would like to spend the rest of my life with my spouse. But why bring in children, which are going to be some sort of a, you know, pullback on me? I can't be as independent, I can't do so. Me and my wife will be perpetually honeymooning and globetrotting and doing whatever we want, because we are not constrained with children. These are also some of the factors that are going to come into play. There are a lot of young women, for example, you know, who have a very close relationship with a boy for years and years, and anybody looking at them would say that they are madly in love with each other, they'll either marry or they'll have a live-in relationship or something. And you ask the girl and she says, I have no romantic inclination towards this guy. He's a buddy, he's a very good friend, we can do whatever we want with each other, but I am not interested in romance or sex or anything, and vice versa. This again is something which never existed. The moment you saw a boy and girl perpetually hanging around alone with each other, it was taken for granted that it's a romantic relationship, no more. Because today they are growing up in an environment where they feel that, you know, if there is a person of the opposite gender with whom I gel very well, and you know, we both can be very good friends and we can do a lot of activities and this and that, we can stay back in each other's house and sleep overnight, we can do whatever we want, but we don't want to, we are not romantically inclined towards each other, and we don't want to have a MC. But again, I come back to something that there is always, whenever it comes to this close relationship, whether it's a close friend or a boyfriend, girlfriend or husband, wife or whatever it is, there is always this element of the emotional insecurity. For example, let's say there is a person, man or woman, who works in an office and in the office gets very friendly with a person of the opposite gender, obviously the spouse gets worried. The spouse says, what's this happening? You know, okay, you have your colleagues and friends, you can mix around, but you are spending all your time alone with that one person in the office. Now, if that person says, whatever it is, yes, I'm spending a lot of time with him and I'm sharing a lot with him, everything is there, but it is not romantic or sexual or something, he is more like a brother to me or something of that sort, immediately the person would back off and say, fine, this is a good this thing. Traditionally, we have also had the Raksha Bandhan. So anytime, you know, there was some tension or something, why this boy and girl are getting close to each other, tie a rakhi and then you are safe. Even your parents would say, why don't you call him over for dinner? We are going out, you'll be alone. Ask him to come and be here and give you company, because you have tied the rakhi, so they used to feel that they are very safe or something of that sort. But now slowly that has led to another very interesting concept which they are now calling as office spouse. That's a very interesting phenomenon, because what is happening is that while the person claims that we do not have a sexual relationship, the sharing is being done at such a personal level that the other partner, the spouse, is obviously getting very, very uncomfortable. Imagine a wife who is having sex only with her husband, but in the office she shares with this man how enjoyable or not enjoyable that sex is. How does it leave that man or woman either way? So this is another interesting phenomenon which has come in and which is growing pretty fast. And on the one side, people take that moral stand saying that I'm not having an extramarital affair, I'm not indulging in romance or sex or something of that sort, he or she is a good friend. But on the other hand, there is this concept of emotional infidelity. Do you have a right to emote with another person, particularly of the opposite gender? That do you think it is right to share at such a deep level with somebody who is not your own spouse or your partner? Now the debate can go on endlessly, there is no answer to it. Yes,
great.
Oh yeah. Today I'm not actually talking about counseling per se, because I'm taking this hour to make you more aware of, you know, what is happening in the changes in the man-woman relationship. When it comes to the counselor's role, as we do in DCS classes or somewhere else, I'll discuss that separately with you. Right now, my focus is on being able to understand, anticipate and prepare for the changes that are coming into man-woman relationship, particularly because, as I told you, I'm repeating again, that it is the most important relationship which affects everything in your life to a very great extent. It affects your children, it affects your other family members, so many of those, you know, factors keep coming into the place. The independence of the young girls is going to bring in a lot of factors. You have more and more women who before marriage are living away from their families, which again 10-20 years back was unheard of. So a girl who has learned how to be independent, to live on her own, the way she will look upon her relationship with her man is going to be different from a girl who stepped out from her parents' house and went straight to her in-laws' house. Now this generation also, there's going to be a lot of changes coming into the thing. Then another factor which is going to affect man-woman relationship in the days to come is the lack of time that they can give to each other. I already know at least half a dozen couples and young couples who should be in their honeymoon phase of their marriage, where the woman has a good 9 to 5 job and the man has a good 9 p.m. to 5 a.m. job, and neither of them wants to give up their job. So it is high dear, by dear, you know, one going out and one coming in, and that one coming in and this one going out. And they are telling themselves, and they are telling even a counselor or somebody who they are sharing with, that we make up for it on weekends. Okay? I'm happy because I also am a person who believes in quality time rather than quantity time. I don't expect a woman to be, you know, 24 hours waiting for her husband or something of that sort. So it's fine. You have this quality time. So what do you do? See, since we don't get time at all during the week, we make the most of the weekends. But how do you do it? There's this concept which says, work hard, party hard. So what we do is that the moment the weekend starts, we are with our gang of friends, we go for this picnic, we go to this resort, we go to this, we go and see a movie, we go and do this, and we are there. 48 hours we are spending together. They don't speak 48 sentences in between those. Except maybe, will you get the popcorn or will I get the popcorn or something of that sort. There is no emotional sharing, which I keep warning people, but they don't understand its significance because according to them, they feel that spending time together, going together for this movie or this picnic or this and that, a party or whatever it is good enough. But I don't think that goes into building a good relationship with the people. And then I've already told you about concept of the midlife crisis, which is hitting more and more people. If they don't work on their man-woman relationship during the developmental phase of their partnership or their marriage, and before you know it, the child-centric stage has come in and you are more focused on your child or your children rather than on your spouse, then as midlife hits you, you will realize that a lot of pent-up emotions and anger and frustration and indifference and all those things sort of things start coming. And that's the reason why I mentioned about divorces in the sector who are married for more than 20 years or that sort of thing. But divorce, of course, is a very extreme thing. Even very, very unhappy marriages, very, very indifferent marriages is what I see in the midlife crisis, where they have emotionally disconnected from each other. And as I always remind, the opposite of love is not hate, the opposite of love is indifference. So if an indifference comes into a man-woman relationship, it is as good as dead. Just because you live under the same roof or you share financial whatever it is or those sort of things, or you go to a party together or something, that does not mean that you really have a relationship. Yes, there are some people who are happy with it and they don't mind it. It's up to them. But definitely somewhere along the line, they will realize how lonely they are when they are putting on this charade of being a couple and being a husband and wife, and they're not working on it. And the time will come when it will hit, they would have traversed on that path so much of a distance that there will be no turning back. They will not be able to build back what they have lost out over the years. And then they are going to be hit with one of the worst diseases, which is already hitting mankind, and it is going to increase tremendously as an epidemic, which is loneliness. You better start inoculating and vaccinating yourself against that. And one of the best ways to do that is to start fighting with your spouse, telling everything that comes to your mind, even if it leads to an argument. Yes, okay.
How do you build the emotional connection?
As I said, yes, absolutely. Many of us develop an emotional disconnect because we say, every time I try to tell my spouse, he or she gets angry, it leads to an argument, children get upset, this. So better stop talking. There are so many issues where I don't even touch upon the topic with my spouse. And those issues just go on adding on. So start. Go back today and have a nice fight with your spouse. It's good for your mental and physical health. Yes, Malti.
I think at least in India, we need to also pay attention to the influence that parents-in-law have over the way. Because very often a girl will say, no, I have to live near my father. I'm sorry to say, in many cases, they have a very, I should say, a negative influence on the way they.
True.
Because they want to be part of their children's life, or they want to be part of their grandchildren's life, and you're building your relationships and making your parents happy.
Because, I'll tell you the reason also, because they are suffering from that disease of loneliness. Yeah. that old man and old lady who should now be enjoying their each other's company and, you know, thinking of what they can do in their sunset years, they find they don't connect with anybody. So they still want to latch on to their daughter who is long married and having children of her own and in-laws and everything, but they want to keep control. And that is how the vicious cycle goes on. Yeah.
Ali, you said that both husband and wife, their career is stable, and they don't want to have children, right?
Some of them.
I know a couple who have children, they both are career stable, but they neglect.
That's even worse. I agree with you, that is worse.
They don't have children and they career stable.
Yes.
Rather than children.
Definitely. They don't have a right to bring in a child into this world and then neglect the child. There is no doubt about the thing. Yeah.
How do you handle this mother-in-law and
do you want to answer it?
Excuse me, I'm a mother-in-law. I'm a daughter-in-law.
I'm a father-in-law.
Yeah. No, but at the same time, what I feel that the way you were saying that now generation, like maybe in the age of 45, 50, yeah. those who have become mother-in-laws or 50, 58, yeah. whatever, yeah. they have become very open also.
Yeah.
The
yeah.
changes
there is a positive thing. There is a positive
thing. Part yeah. of their children's life.
Yes,
so they are
yes,
giving
yes,
them
yes.
a lot of freedom.
Very true, very true.
So that change is also happening very
yes,
nicely.
Yes,
it's
yes,
yes, not the negative thing anymore that my daughter-in-law is not coming, she's not listening. They don't even expect that.
They don't expect.
Yes,
yeah.
yes.
Yeah, they don't expect.
One wonderful exactly. case that I came across recently with a husband who was very, very oppressive with his wife. He was an alcoholic. He was not earning anything, and he created a lot of hassle till the wife walked out. A few months after that, the husband's mother threw out her son and told the daughter-in-law, you can come back to our house and live with us because she has a child. We would like to give the child a family and this and that. We don't want you to live alone. And we'll see to it. While I will continue to communicate with my son, but I will see to it that he doesn't come when you are there. So the husband is supposed to come and visit his mother only when his wife is not there. Take permission that from the mother, saying that when the wife is not there, then only I'll come. He can meet the child, he can meet his mother, and he can go back. The wife is being protected by the... There are definitely very positive steps. To answer your question, if we can call a conference of Gautam Buddha, Lord Rama, Lord Krishna, Jesus Christ, Muhammad, everybody all put together, maybe there is a chance that they may be able to give us a solution to it. I definitely cannot.
You said that a child takes the decision for the parents. Why is it so?
Yes, exposure and that
communication
that I can say anything to my parent, all these factors. Mm-hmm. That's a different topic altogether, how children, even the preteens, pre-adolescent children have so much of awareness and that decision making and that thing of saying what is right and what is wrong and what I want and you can't force anything on me and that sort of thing. So it runs into
parents,
that.
No, but as parents, are we giving them that independence or the freedom to
yes,
say whenever
yes.
they
yeah, yeah. Either we are giving it to them as parents, or even if we don't, then beyond the parents, everything else is giving them the feeling, whether it is the schooling system or the society or the media or the Facebook or whatever it is, somewhere that is being pushed into.
But I think which is fine, right? They
which is fine, which is fine, which is good actually, which is really good.
There
are only some precautions to be taken in those cases. We'll talk about it on some other occasion as and when it comes. Let me just quickly tell you about the announcements. As you know, we meet on the third Thursday of the month. This time we will be meeting in January on the fourth Thursday, not the third, because 16th I'm not.